बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। इन रेफरेंस टू अवर प्रीवियस कंटिन्यूएशन दैट इज पीडियाट्रिक हेमाटोलॉजी एंड ऑन्कोलॉजी, इफ यू रिव्यू योर प्रीवियस डिस्कशन, वी कवर्ड अनीमिया, स्पेशली आयरन डेफिशिएंसी एंड एप्लास्टिक अनीमिया इन चिल्ड्रन, देन हिमोलिटिक अनीमिया, एंड टुडे इन रेफरेंस टू पीडियाट्रिक हेमाटोलॉजी एंड इन अवर नेक्स्ट लेक्चर रिलेटेड टू पीडियाट्रिक ऑन्कोलॉजी, टुडे वी आर डिस्कसिंग इन नेक्स्ट 25 मिनट्स, 25-30 मिनट्स, व्हाट आर डिफरेंट ब्लीडिंग डिसऑर्डर व्हिच अ पीडियाट्रिशियन, अ क्लिनिशियन कम अक्रॉस व्हाइल लुकिंग आफ्टर चिल्ड्रन इन एन आउट पेशेंट क्लिनिक। द ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ टुडेज प्रेजेंटेशन इज टू शेयर विद यू व्हाट इज द नॉर्मल होम्योस्टेसिस, how we should approach a baby who present with some bleeding manifestation, and then what are common bleeding and coagulation disorders in children, and finally what are the current strategies in reference to management of these bleeding disorder. Let's start with a clinical scenario about a 4 years old boy who presented in our outpatient clinic with limping gait for last 2 days. This baby has been having similar problem and during last 3 years he had two episode, and today on the examination in our outpatient clinic he was having swelling of left knee and with a marked hematoma which is reflecting on the discoloration of the skin. So your assignment is what to do about this 4-year-old boy. But before moving forward, let's have a look on the appearance of his left knee joint. You can appreciate that it is well swollen knee joint, which has obliterated the sharp contours of patella and margins of tibia fibula as well as lower end of femur. So this is the appearance of that 4-year-old boy who presented with limping gait for last 2 days. So our approach is that first we make an endeavor, we make an effort to give relief to his pain. So we suggest him first take a rest on a splint so that it should have a minimal movements. Then we give some analgesic anti-inflammatory agent which help the baby to come out of that acute pain. So before moving to the management, after relieving his pain, we ask about history. Then we have a good look of examination of this patient, request for investigation, and then we come up with the final diagnosis of this patient and ultimately proceed with the appropriate management. This is the plan of this young boy. So let's have a look what is the normal homeostasis. This is the pictorial representation of a small blood vessel. You can appreciate that in the vascular lumen, red blood cells and platelets and white blood cells, they are moving freely in the microvasculature of the capillaries and arteries, but then there is development of a injury, development of a break in the continuity of endothelium of the small blood vessel. So this opening or discontinuity initiate a set of process in which red blood cells, they come out of these issue leading to bleeding that area, and then activation of these platelets by the adhesion to the collagen and the nude endothelium in that damaged area. So that activate that blood platelets, and that lead to cascade of activation of the platelets, activation of the tissue factor, which initiate a series of coagulation changes, which ultimately lead to formation of fibrin and the formation of platelet aggregation, which leads to a platelet plaque. that platelet plug, which is comprises of a meshwork of fibrin in which these activated platelets, they stuck up and ultimately lead to blockage of bleeding from that damaged or injured blood vessels. That is the normal cascade of bleeding activation, or what we called as whenever injury to the small blood vessels, how platelets, a set of different coagulations from 1 to 13 number of coagulation factors, they activate, leading to formation of fibrin and platelet clot. So we go to the history to that young boy, and in the history our focus is on the age of onset, when the first manifestation of bleeding appeared in that boy. Obviously, some of the coagulation problems, they are X-linked, other are autosomal recessive, so sex of the patient is important. How frequently baby is having that problem, we have to determine that what is the severity of bleeding. It is a mild bleeding or coagulation problem, it is moderate to severe bleeding or coagulation problem. So frequency of bleeding episodes, that help to differentiate these different issues. Location of the bleeding, where does that manifestation, either it is cutaneous bleeding, it is bleeding from the gums, from the mucous membrane, or some of these coagulation problems or bleeding disorder, they may be having intramuscular bleeding or bleeding into the abdomen or sometime into the closed cavity of the skull. So location of the bleeding also helpful in differentiating the underlying reason of that bleeding disorder. Does its patient is having spontaneous bleeding, or it results from minor trauma? So all these issues, they should be reviewed in these children before coming up for investigation in these children. When we move on to examination, so the important thing is the patient is having just petechial or skin lesions, or they may be having hematomas. Does there is evidence of bleeding into the joints, like in this patient who present with hemoarthrosis? Does this patient, in addition to bleeding and manifestation, has some visceromegaly in the form of lymphadenopathy or in the form of hepatosplenomegaly? Patient is sick looking, like in patient with leukemia, lymphomas, etc., or he is playful and active in patient with ITP or different type of coagulopathies. Does this associated with dysmorphic feature, especially in reference to congenital problems of the platelets or congenital type of aplastic anemia? So presence of telangiectasia. So different evidences on physical examination are very helpful in the final conclusion about the underlying platelets problem or coagulopathies. So on the basis of history and examination, our main objective is that to determine that is it a problem related with some blood vessels, or there is a problem with the platelets number or functions, or there is some the underlying problem is related to different coagulation factors. So this is our main objective from the history and examination. We also go in the past history, that is there any bleeding tendency in these patients that may be manifest in the form of easy bruisability with minor trauma, bleeding from the gums at the time of just brushing the teeth, sometime minor type of bleeding or coagulation problem. They even move up to the age of adolescence, when the young girls, they have menorrhagia or postpartum type of bleeding. So for determining the nature of bleeding or determining the severity of bleeding, we must ask about that what is the nature of underlying bleeding tendency in these patients. Even a bleeding at the time of vaccination or sometimes bleeding at the time of circumcision is also a clue for the presence of bleeding or coagulopathy in children. As I mentioned, that sometimes we come across just with the problem of the blood vessels. So minor blood vessels, they have bleeding tendency in infections like meningococcemia, or sometimes some autoimmune problems like nonsmoller purpura with mild to small size blood vessels, vasculitis, they present with purpuric spots in patient with autoimmune vasculitis in the form of nonsmoller purpura. This is the picture of a baby who present with bleeding in with these purpuric or recumbotic lesions in the lower limbs and very marked such lesions at the site of buttocks. So a baby who present with such lesions in the lower limbs or in the buttock area with normal number of platelets, that reflects that patient is having Henoch-Schönlein purpura or vasculitis purpura. In reference to platelets, sometimes there is decreased number of platelets, what we called as thrombocytopenia, and in which is cause of skin manifestations or mucosal bleeding. The most common is immune thrombocytopurpura, or what we called as acute ITP, in which there is significant droppage of platelets. But in patient with bone marrow infiltration, like in acute lymphoblastic leukemia, they also have thrombocytopenia because of low platelets counts. These are the typical manifestation in a baby of acute ITP. You can appreciate that there are small size petechial purpuric rashes on the extremities, not only in the upper limb but also shins or extensor surface of the lower limb, also a common site for thrombocytopenic manifestation purpura. So this is the typical appearance in patient with acute ITP. So when we have gone through history and examination, we ask for simple investigation like CBC and platelets count. But at the same time, it is recommended that when a baby presents with any type of bleeding manifestation, so in addition to CBC and platelets counts, ask for prothrombin time or activated partial thromboplastin time. These simple investigation, CBC, peripheral picture, PT and APTT, will help you to define that what advanced investigation, what specialized investigations are subsequently needed to come up with the underlying problem of the coagulation or platelets problem. So from these simple investigation, we move on to thrombin time or platelets aggregation studies to see if the patient is having platelets functional defects or what we called as thrombosthenia. So thrombin time, platelets functional disorder, and ultimately factor bioassay help you to finally clinch or finally define that what is the underlying defective coagulation factor bleeding manifestation in a child who present with different type of platelets or coagulation problems. So as I mentioned, that in reference to platelets, acquired problems, what we call as acute ITP, is the most common problem. But sometimes we do have some functional defects of the platelet, what we call as thrombosthenia, and some inherited problems related to functional defects of the platelets. Like DIC, they are the causes of thrombocytopenia in children. In reference to treatment option for acute ITP, steroid or prednisolone is the most effective treatment, but at the same time, use of intravenous aminoglobulin G is very effective in patients with acute ITP. So you can have any of the choice of steroid or IV immunoglobulin, although the first choice is IV immunoglobulin, which within hours or within 1 or 2 days help to improve the platelet counts and get rid of the bleeding manifestation secondary to thrombocytopenia. While in resistant cases, use of Rogam or monoclonal antibodies is also indicated. This is the appearance of a patient who present with absent radius and thrombocytopenia, what we call TAR syndrome or thrombocytopenia with absent radius syndrome. You can see there is only ulna in this patient, there is no radius. Normally there are two bones in the forearm. In reference to functional disorder of the platelets, these Glanzmann thrombocythemia or Bernard Soulier, they are the name of problems in which the number of platelets is normal, but the function of the platelets is not appropriate. They are not able to produce platelet clot in spite of the fact that these patients, they have normal number of the platelets. Von Willebrand disease is a problem in which there is a compositive of von Willebrand coagulation factor, as well as there is decreased number of the platelets. So coagulopathy as well as thrombocytopenia is seen in patient with von Willebrand disorder. They present with easy bruisability, bleeding from the nose or gums. In older adolescent girl with menorrhagia. So these are the common manifestations of von Willebrand disorder. Out of coagulopathies, we will touch upon the most common problem in pediatric age group, which results from deficiency of coagulation factor 8. The name given to that is hemophilia. There are three types of hemophilia. Hemophilia A, which I mentioned, is the classical hemophilia due to factor A deficiency, factor 9 or Christmas disease, or hemophilia B, and factor 11 or factor hemophilia C, that is factor 11 deficiency. We can classical hemophilia A, we can classify into mild, moderate and severe, depending upon that how much the normal coagulation activity is present in this patient. If the status of coagulation factor is less than 1 of normal level, that is severe hemophilia. If the status of coagulation factor activity is 1 to 5%, they present with whenever they present with some surgical problem. While in patient with mild type of hemophilia, the coagulation factor activity is 5 to 30%. Patients with major or severe bleeding, they present whenever there's in the bleeding in the head and neck area inside the skull or from the GI tract. They present with hemoarthrosis, like our index patient which we discussed earlier on. So severe type of hemophilia, they present with bleeding into the skull, GI tract or into the joint cavity. So our objective is that we try to build up their status of coagulation factors at least 80 to 100%. And we are given 50 units per kg of factor 8, which will help to build their level up to 80 to 100% of their normal level. These are different manifestations in the form of hemoarthrosis, in the form of caput hematoma at the time of bleeding, massive bleeding from the gum, in oral cavity. So these patients, they can have a patient with classical hemophilia, they can manifest with these different type of bleeding manifestations. Some of these patients, they may be have a muscle bleeding into the muscles, like into the muscles of thigh, in hamstring muscles and vastus muscles. They very liable to develop bleeding tendency into the muscles in the form of intramuscular hematomas. If hemoarthrosis is recurrent, and it's of long standing duration, you can appreciate that intra-articular space is gone. There is irregular ends of the bones because of massive bleeding. There is the flatness or sharp contour of the platelets, that is gone. Intra-articular space is gone. So ultimately they lead to ankylosis of these joints, and patient, they are not able to move about freely. So recurrent or chronic type of hemarthrosis, one can appreciate, one can have such type of radiological appearance in patients with chronic or prolonged arthropathies in patients of hemophilia A. Management of hemophilia A, the first and foremost is to give rest to this patient to avoid pain by giving a good spleen to this patient. As I mentioned earlier on, by use of good analgesics or morphine type of analgesic, we try to relieve their pain because the pain is very cumbersome, very aggressive pain, and we have to take the help of even sometime morphine type of analgesics. We build up the coagulation factors with the use of factor 8 concentrate or with the use of fresh frozen plasma. Sometime even we have to take the help of blood transfusion if there is excessive bleeding. When patients come out of that bleeding problem, we try to mobilize and take the help of physiotherapy and rehabilitate these patients. The basis of good comprehensive care is that you need all these specialists in the care of this patient. Hematologist, physiotherapist, nursing care till there is significant improvement in the mobility of their muscles, improvement in their status of coagulation factors. If there is recurrent gum bleeding, dentist has to be involved because it is an X-linked problem running in the families. So a geneticist is part of that comprehensive team care, and above all, psychosocial needs, that a smart social worker should also be part of the team which is looking after patients of hemophilia. So a couple of decades back, in patients with hemophilia, because of recurrent bleeding, because of non-availability of the coagulation factors, factor concentrate, these children, they develop recurrent hemarthrosis, which ultimately end up with ankylosis of these joints, and that make the patients a parasite dependent on the other for their movements because of their limitation of movements because of recurrent joint problem. But with the advancement of availability of good factor 8 concentrate, free availability, good social services, and the use of involvement of the physiotherapist, good nursing care, now these patients, they in spite of their problems, they enjoy their life, they participate in physical activity, and this is the current status of care of hemophilic patients. If we have a smart approach, we can make the life of this patient so enjoyable. So thank you very much for patient listening, and you go about this lecture, and will be given a few MCQs to answer, to update your knowledge and to review your learning from this presentation. Thank you very much for patient listening.